Hi everyone, my name is Adrian Ranea, and in this video, I will present on CF equivalence encodings in Webox implementation. Join work with Barprenet. Let's start. In addition, cryptographic algorithms have been designed to be secure in the black box model, where one assumes that the adversary can tamper with the input and output behavior of the algorithm. For example, AES is a popular block cipher that was designed to be secure against black box attacks like differential cryptanalysis. However, electronic devices running crypto computations can leak information, time, or power consumption, and many crypto algorithms, while securing the black box model, can be fully broken by exploiting this leakage. This model, where the adversary can also get some noisy and limited side channel information, is the gray box model. We have some cryptographic countermeasures to protect implementation in this model, such as masking, a popular countermeasure to prevent DPA or power consumption attacks. In some particular scenarios, the adversaries might get full control of the device running the crypto computation. The gray box model isn't enough. To model this worst case scenario for mainly software implementation, it was proposed the white box model, where one assumes that the adversary can fully observe, without noise, and modify at will any value during the execution of the cryptographic algorithm. In particular, a white box adversary can intercept the calls to the operating system, attach a debugger to the implementation, and tamper with intermediate values of the execution. The most popular white box countermeasure is obfuscation with encodings, but reaction attacks have shown they are insecure, and this is the focus of this talk. To protect software implementations of existing block ciphers in the white box model, several methods to build white box implementations have been published. These methods have in common that they propose a compiler that takes the cipher key and some randomness and outputs an implementation where the key is hidden within the implementation. The security goal that these methods try to achieve is key extraction resistance, meaning an adversary in possession of the Webox implementation should not be able to extract the key, assuming the adversary knows the specification of the cipher and the compiler, but doesn't know the key or the original randomness used. All the academic methods to build Webox implementation of block cipher share this limitation. First, they only aim for key extraction resistance, but there are other threats in the white box model as decryption attack or code lifting. Decryption attacks, meaning attacks that invert the implementation, are very difficult to protect against, as a white box implementation that is secure against this attack will turn a symmetric key into a public key scheme, an extremely ambitious goal. For code lifting attacks, there are other white box constructions, like incompressible ciphers. These are new ciphers designed from scratch that can be implemented with huge implementation and cannot be compressed with knowledge of the key, thus making code lifting much harder. However, since they propose new ciphers, they don't address the problem of protecting implementation of existing ciphers. Another limitation of the white box implementation of existing cipher is that they are all fixed key implementation, meaning that the key is hard-coded within the implementation. We don't know how to make dynamic key implementation where the key is given as input in some obfuscate way. The third main limitation is the external encodings. The Webox implementation published in academia are not functionally equivalent to the underlying cipher, since they add additional transformation at the beginning and at the end of the cipher. These so-called external encodings are independent of the cipher key, and they are assumed to be unknown by the adversary. Without external encodings, all published Webox implementations are trivially unsecure, but when they are used, they introduce some practical limitation. For example, if one wants to preserve the input and output behavior of the cipher. That's why several companies have designed Webox implementation without external encodings, but they rely their security on hiding the specification of the design, as opposed to the academic implementation where the method is public. It turned out that hiding the design is not enough. Several webbox attacks based on Gatebot techniques like DPA or DFA can fully break this webbox implementation based on security by obscurity. Here, in this work, we focus on webbox implementation where the design is public and the security is based on the secrecy of the key and the original randomness use. All the methods to build webbox implementation of existing block ciphers are based on the initial webbox implementation of AES proposed by Shaw and his colleagues, and now these implementations are also called CEO implementations. The idea of a CEO implementation is as follows. First, the cipher is decomposed into rounds as usual. Then, for each round, one appends random permutation called wrong encodings to the input and to the output. To preserve the functionality, the input encodings of the next round is chosen to cancel the previous output encodings, and so on until the first and the last encodings are the only ones that are not cancelled. They are the external encodings. Finally, each encoded round, meaning the round together with the wrong encodings, is implemented independently. The encoded rounds need to be implemented in such a way that the wrong key material and the wrong encodings cannot be extracted. To do so, each encoded round is decomposed into functions or blocks with a small input size, and each block is encoded again with random encodings. The encoded blocks, the blue boxes to the right, are implemented as lookup tables. Thus, encoded rounds are represented in the software implementation as networks of lookup tables. The main bottleneck of CEO implementations is the size. Since lookup tables take exponential size in the bit input size, CEO implementation consider encodings that are composed of small nonlinear permutation and wider linear permutation. For example, the first whitebox implementation of AES used 4-bit nonlinear encodings and 8-bit linear encodings. In general, a CEO implementation uses lookup tables with bit size similar to the linear encodings or 2 times the bit size of the linear encodings. All CEO implementations have been broken, meaning that the phishing attacks have been found to extract the cipher key. Most attacks consist of 2 steps. A reduction on the encoding space and an exhaustive search over the reduced encoding space to extract the wrong key. The crucial step is the reduction one, which consists of finding a new encoded wrong function with the same key material, but where the encodings now belong to a smaller space where an exhaustive search is feasible. While many efficient but specific attacks to whitebox implementation of AES have been published, just a few generic attacks to the CEO framework have been proposed. These generic attacks can be applied to any CEO implementation of an SPN cipher, a substitution permutation network block cipher. To show you the limitation of these generic attacks, let's consider an encode round of an arbitrary CEO implementation of an SPN cipher. Here, we are representing the rank of the cipher as the S-box layer, the nonlinear layer composed of small n-bit S-boxes, and the affine layer, which includes the addition of the round key and the linear layer. The first thing that we remark in this paper is that these generic attacks don't fully break CEO implementation, but they can reduce the encodings to self-equivalence of the S-box layer. A self-equivalence of a function is a pair of affine permutations that when composed to the function, the same function is obtained. Here, in the slide, only the output encoding has been reduced to a self-equivalence, strictly speaking, half of a self-equivalence, but the same reduction can be applied to the input encoding. The complexity of this reduction mainly depends on the input bit size of the nonlinear encodings and the input bit size of the S-box. And since the complexity of this reduction is similar to the actual size of the CEO implementation, this reduction is very efficient. Otherwise, the size of the implementation will be impractical. For whitebox implementation of AES, There are specific algorithms to remove these self-equivalence encodings, making the extraction of the wrong key material trivial. However, for other ciphers, we don't know what's the security of these self-equivalence encodings, and that is exactly what this paper studies. As opposed to CU implementations, self-equivalence encodings can be implemented in a more efficient and simple way, but we formalize this paper as self-equivalence implementations. To create a self-equivalence implementation, the idea is as follows. First, the cipher is decomposed into rounds. Then, for each round, we introduce a random self-equivalence of the Xbox layer. Note that this does not change the functionality. We continue adding self-equivalence up to the first and last round, which are composed with random affine permutation, the external encodings. And finally, instead of considering encode rounds, we consider encode affine layers that are composed of the affine layer, part of the self-equivalence of the previous Xbox layer, and part of the self-equivalence of the next Xbox layer. Note that the Xbox layer doesn't need to be protected, and since the encode affine layers are affine, they can be easily implemented as binary matrices and binary constants, and thus the evaluation time and the size of a self-equivalence implementation is quadratic. While CU implementations can be reduced to practical self-equivalence implementation, the opposite is not always possible. Since CU implementations have exponential size in terms of the bit size of the encodings, self-equivalence implementation can only be translated to CU if the self-equivalence encodings consist of the concatenation of a small affine permutation. Otherwise, the resulting CU implementation will have impractical size. In this paper, we formalize self-equivalence composed of a small permutation as diagonal self-equivalence. More formally, for the linear case, for example, we say a pair of linear permutation AB is a diagonal self-equivalence of F if, first, they satisfy the self-equivalence property, and second, the matrix representation of A and B are block diagonal matrices, up to some block, row, and column permutation. While the idea of self-equivalence implementation was previously considered, it was only considered an implementation of AS with diagonal encodings, which they show it was unsecure. However, self-equivalence implementation with non-diagonal encodings or just other ciphers have not been considered. Thus, the first problem that emerged is how to know whether an Xbox layer have non-diagonal self-equivalence or just diagonal ones. In this paper, we consider this problem for the first time and show some necessary conditions in order to have non-diagonal self-equivalences. Let S be an Xbox and consider an Xbox layer SL built from concatenating multiple times this Xbox. We prove that if the Xbox layer has a non-diagonal self-equivalence, then the Xbox have a non-trivial additive self-equivalence and a non-trivial linear component. An additive self-equivalence is just an affine self-equivalence where the linear part is the identity. In terms of differential and linear cryptanalysis, these two conditions are equivalent to having a non-trivial differential and linear approximation with probability 1. In the paper, we prove this theorem for the general case, where the Xbox layer is built from different Xboxes and there is an extra condition about the linear structure of the Xbox. However, here we will consider a single Xbox for simplicity. The idea of the proof is that if the Xbox layer has a non-diagonal self-equivalence, then there is a function linear equivalent to the Xbox layer that has a very simple non-diagonal self-equivalence. Thus, we extract the condition from this simple function and then translate the condition via the linear equivalence. In the proof, we show the connection among self-equivalences, linear structure, Boolean components, and some linear invariants. While this theorem provides necessary conditions in order to have non-diagonalizable events, it seems that these conditions are quite close to the sufficient ones, as we check for four weightless boxes and saw that these conditions were also sufficient. Most SPN ciphers employ S-boxes which are cryptographically strong, meaning that they don't have ISDNCF equivalents or linear components. For these ciphers, the S-box layers do not have non-diagonalizable equivalents, and we can count and fully characterize the safe equivalents of the S-box layer. In particular, if we have an S-box layer given by the concatenation of a single S-box, then we can get all the safe equivalents of the S-box layer by taking safe equivalents of the small S-box and then applying any reordering of the S-boxes as shown in the slides. While we apply this study of diagonal safe equivalents to analyze the security of safe equivalence encodings, these results are of independent interest and might be useful for other applications related to safe equivalences. Similar to CU implementations, the security goal of safe equivalence implementation is key extraction resistance, where it is assumed that the adversary knows the specification of the cipher and the safe equivalence design, but doesn't know the cipher key or the random use to sample the safe equivalences. Safe equivalence implementation also require external encodings, otherwise they will be trivially unsecure. Note that the external encodings doesn't need to be safe equivalence, and they can be taken as random affine permutation. This implies that current whitebox attacks that are based on greybox techniques such as DPA or DFA cannot be applied to safe equivalence implementation directly. In fact, only a few attacks to whitebox implementation of AES with diagonal encodings have been published. No generic attack to safe equivalence implementation have been considered this far. That is why in this paper we consider the first generic attack to safe equivalence implementation of SPN ciphers. Since most SPN ciphers consider strong S-boxes like AES, we consider this case, which reduced to the study of the security of diagonal encodings. As most whitebox attacks, our generic attack is also a reduction attack, meaning we describe a method to get new encode affine layers for which the wrong encodings are restricted to a smaller encoding space. Afterwards, the key can be recovered by performing an exhaustive search over the reduced encoding space. A reduction attack is based on affine and linear equivalence problems, that is, on functional equation where the unknowns are affine or linear permutation. The key property that we use is that if we know one solution and the safe equivalence of the middle function f, which is known, then we can generate all the solution of the linear equivalence problem. And we propose two classes of equivalence problems that can be exploited to mount the reduction attack: the centralizer problems and the asymmetric problems. The centralizer problem is a class of linear equivalence problems that allows to reduce the encoding space to a particular set of self-equivalence of the linear layer blocks, called the centralizer. We will see this with a toy example. Let's consider an intermediate round of a self-equivalence implementation of an SPN cipher with two S-boxes in the S-box layer. In addition, let's assume that the safe equivalence encodings are linear and not affine. An encode affine layer is given as an encode constants and an encode matrix. For the centralizer problem, we ignore the constant and focus on encode matrix. The encode matrix, which does not store any key material, is given by the linear layer of the cipher and the safe equivalence encodings. Here, I denotes the input encoding, which is part of the safe equivalence of the previous S-box layer, and O denotes the output encoding, which is part of the safe equivalence of the next S-box layer. For this example, we will focus on reducing the first block of the output encoding, O1, but in a similar way, the rest of the encoding blocks can be reduced. The idea of the centralizer problem is to consider blocks of the encode matrix and its inverse, which both can be computed by the adversary, such that these blocks depend on the same output encoding block, O1, and they cancel the input encode block, I1, in this case. By composing these blocks, the adversary gets the following relation, where the left-hand side is known is the composition of blocks of the encode matrix, and the middle part of the right-hand side is also known. Note that the middle part is not necessarily the identity. The second factor is the block 1-1 of the inverse of the linear layer, and not the inverse of the block 1-1 of the linear layer. From the previous functional relation, where O1 was the only unknown, we can consider the following linear equivalence problem, given by two equations. The first equation is the relation that we found before, just replacing O1 by an unknown linear permutation X, and the second equation restricts X to be a self-equivalence of S. After getting one solution, by applying some simple linear transformation, we can get a new encode matrix, where the output encoding block O1 has been reduced to O1'. This new output encoding block is still part of a self-equivalence of S, similar to O1, but in addition, it verifies that it is an element of the centralizer of L, that is, the set of matrices that commute with L, which actually is a subgroup of a self-equivalence of L. In other words, the centralizer problem reduces the wrong encodings to the intersection between the self-equivalence of the S-box layer and the centralizer of the linear layer blocks. Thus, security of self-equivalence implementation not only depends on the self-equivalence of the S-box layer, but also on the self-equivalence structure of the blocks of the linear layer. To show an example, for AES, the number of self-equivalence of the S-box is slightly greater than 2 to the 8, and we can consider centralizers of size 2 to the 8 that lead to a weak reduction. However, what this shows is that even if we replace the S-box of AES to one that has more self-equivalence, it will not impact the security, since we can always reduce the encoding space to one of these centralizers containing 2 to the 8 elements. The other class of equivalence problems that we propose is the asymmetric problem class. We will see this type of equivalence problem with an example following the toy construction from before. In a similar way as in the centralizer problem, one can find a relation involving the output encoding block O1, where the left-hand side is known, the middle part consists of the S-box composed with some linear layer block, and the last part in the right-hand side is some linear function that depends on the encodings, thus unknown. From the previous functional relation, we can consider the following equivalence problem given by two equations. The first equation can be derived from the relation, just replacing O1 by the variable X and the unknown linear function by the variable Y, and the second equation restrict X to be a self-equivalence of S. Strictly speaking, a self-equivalence is a pair of functions, and in the paper, we call each one the right and the left self-equivalence. Thus, strictly speaking, since the output encodings are right self-equivalence of the S-box layer, we append to the linear equivalence problem the restriction that X is a right self-equivalence. Then, after getting one solution and applying some simple linear transformation, we can obtain a new encode matrix where the output encoding block O1 has been reduced to O1', such that this new output encoding block is still a right self-equivalence of the S-box, but in addition, it is also a left self-equivalence of the middle factor of the linear equivalence problem. In other words, the asymmetric problem exploits the intersection between the right self-equivalence of the S-box and the the left safe equivalence of the S-box composed with a linear layer block. For these two examples, the asymmetric problem was a linear equivalence problem since we assumed that the rank columns were linear. But in general, the asymmetric problem is an affine equivalence problem. To give you an example for AIS, if we apply first the centralizer problem and then the asymmetric problem, then we can reduce the encoding space of O1' to a single element. In other words, we can fully recover the output encoding block, and similar for the rest of the encoding blocks, which makes the wrong key extraction afterwards trivial. The centralizer and the asymmetric problem are two generic classes of equivalence problem, but for a particular self-equivalence implementation, one can also find specific equivalence problems. Nevertheless, the idea is the same: to find some equivalence problem with a small solution set that include a block of the wrong encodings as a solution. We arrive to the end of this presentation, and here there are the concluding remarks of this work. First, we show in this work how a CGI implementation can be efficiently transformed into a self-equivalence implementation, while the opposite is not always possible. Second, we analyze when S-box layers have not their self-equivalence, and we obtain some necessary conditions, namely additive self-equivalence, linear components, and linear extraction. On the other hand, strong S-box layers only have diagonal self-equivalence, and in this case, we can characterize and count the number of self-equivalences. Last, we propose a generic attack on self-equivalence implementation of SPN cipher with strong S-box layers. This reduction attack, which is based on equivalence problems, shows how the web of security of a self-equivalence implementation highly depends on the properties of the cipher components. As a result, a cipher with a linear layer with big centralizer and an S-box layer with many unsimilar left and right self-equivalence will resist the generic attack, which is currently the only one. Therefore, self-equivalence implementation of cipher with weak wrong function is a very interesting line of research that can lead to promising WebOx implementation. Thank you for your time.